Hello, FCM friends. This is David Ginn in the Ginnville Workshop with a lecture I call Kids Love This and So Will You, part one of the lecture, which is actually going to be in three parts. Many of you know that a couple of years ago, I put out the biggest book of my career. It's called Kids Show Magic Compendium. I'm going to be doing some things out of it today, but obviously I can't do it all because the book is 544 pages, 900 color photos, and the thing weighs 5 pounds. It makes a great doorstop. So remember, I'll be referring to this book and other books I've written from time to time. If you'd like to find out more information and special FCM prices, email me at ginbooks@gmail.com. I'll try to say this several times during the lecture, just so you'll remember, ginbooks, G-I-N-N-B-O-O-K-S, at gmail.com. Let me snap back here for just a minute and say that the first thing I want to show you in the lecture, among about three or four warm-up type tricks, came out of my parade in the Linking Ring magazine in the month of June. For you who are in the IBM, you saw it, a great cover story by Sammy Smith, and I want to share with you something I've never shown in lectures. Many, many years ago, I was doing a whole series of summer reading shows around South Georgia, about 40 in all, at the libraries in the summertime, of course. And I talked to them about reading and books and this kind of thing, doing magic. And the kids at one library came in with pieces of paper, and I said to this one boy, "What is that piece of paper you have in your hand?" He said, "Well, that's my summer reading list." I said, "Oh, yeah, summer reading list, huh?" He says, "I've got 20 books here. I've read all these books." He showed me, and he said, "And I'm finished with my reading." And I said, "Finish with your reading? You mean finish with your reading?" I said, "I'm never finished with my reading. I'm always reading. I'm always reading a book or a magazine or the instructions to a new magic trick. Things like that. I'm always R-E-A-D-I-N-G. I am always reading," just like that. And that's what I told the boys and girls. That's my point of view. I'm always reading. Reading is what? You what? Oh, ignore that. That dropped on the table and sometimes drops on the floor. I guess you want to see the pieces, right? The torn up pieces. You think I tore it up and switched one from the other? Well, whatever happened, the message is still the same. I'm always reading. I love to read. As far as I'm concerned, reading is forever. And that's my story, and I'm sticking to it. Now, as I say, this is described in the June issue of the Linking Ring, but I just happen to have another one set up to show you in this lecture. This is the old Chinese laundry ticket, and made it into a reading message. Here's what happens. You print some of these. I did these out of the computer, and then I had a bunch of them printed at the printer so I could, you know, do the trick. It takes two reading ones for every forever one. So that's how big they are. And on the back is taped another one. And what I've done is fold up the forever message and put it inside of a reading one. So the reading ones are taped together back to back. Therefore, when you tear like this, keeping all the pieces in front, you then turn it backwards after you've folded the pieces in just like this. You see what I'm doing? Folding them in all to the front, and then in doing this, turn it over. They don't know what you're doing. And open up the back side, and it comes out saying reading. And in a real show, I would probably let it drop on the floor and the kids would tell me about it. But I finish showing reading, ditch this, keep telling my story, pick this up, and when you pick up the pieces and open them up, it says forever. In fact, that was the name of the show, Reading is Forever. Now, you can adapt this to a gospel message or any kind of educational message you want, just a new adaptation of the old Chinese laundry ticket. Now, since we're talking about reading, let me tell you what, I say this to the kids. I got on the airplane recently, and I bought a book in the airport. It was called How to Solve Rubik's Cube. It tells you all about Rubik's Cube and how it was invented, and it gives you all these diagrams and drawings in the book, and the idea is that you read them and look at them and you figure out how to solve Rubik's Cube. Except for one thing. I got on that plane and I didn't have a Rubik's Cube with me, you know, and what I really needed was a Rubik's Cube so that I could practice solving Rubik's Cube. But unfortunately, I didn't have one with me. If I had, I would have been practicing a whole lot on the plane with the Rubik's Cube. So if you get on a plane, be sure you carry your Rubik's Cube if you buy this book. And because children have touched and played with Rubik's Cube so much, they think this is amazing. I remember the first school show I used it on, they were just flabbergasted. Here's what's going on. This is a hollow book, and in the back it's got a compartment and it's got elastic. And you take these cardboard Rubik's Cubes that have rubber bands inside of them, you fold them up, they fold very easily. And by the way, if you get one of these from GetMagic.org, I give you about a dozen extra rubber bands to put inside your cube in case one ever breaks. But you know what's funny? This is the first one that I put together, and I'm going to show you this up close. There they are inside, and I have never changed my rubber bands at all. So here's your book, and it has two or three pages that you can flip through at the front showing the diagrams, then turn it towards you, and as you talk, you just reach in, lift the cubes out of the elastic. They pop open thanks to the rubber bands. There we go. I stack them up, turning them different ways, and that is how to solve Rubik's Cube. Now, carrying these, you don't want to leave them folded up in the book. So what I did when I started using in this my show all the time, I got a little box. This is the exact box. And as you can see, the cubes all fit inside. So I put them inside, close my little Rubik's Cube box, as you see me doing here. And this goes in my suitcase just so. So when I get to the next show, I take the cubes out, set them up in the book, and I'm ready to go. How to solve Rubik's Cube. That's what I call it. Now, I guess you want to meet my rabbit. Might as well let you meet him. He's here, but he's an unusual rabbit. I'll show you in a second. You've probably all seen me do something with this flower. I've been doing a routine for 30 years, thanks to Trevor Lewis, where you take a flower you're trying to make bloom and stick it under your arm until you turn backwards and you flip it open. Well, this is the blooming flower that goes up and down like this. Now, because of that, you can do this and it's gone and it reappears right behind your head. Or you can take it like this, throw it over there, and it reappears right here. So you understand how the blooming flower works. Let me show you how you can combine it with what I think is a wonderful thing for children. This is Harry the Rabbit puppet, and he is a full body puppet. You see he's got the four legs, and he's got big old floppy ears, and he can wave at people like this, and he can clap his hands. He can even pout and cry if you get on to him. But anyway, there he is, Harry the Rabbit. Now, Harry, let me show you, loves flowers. He loves flowers. In fact, he loves them so much, he likes to eat them. Harry, put that flower back. Do not eat up the flower. Now, with children, if you look the other way and Harry does this, they go crazy about this. Put the flower back. Put it back. Just put it back. Now, anyway, and you can go on like this. In my routine in the Kid Show Magic Compendium book, this rabbit, after doing the flower and some other things, changes into a real live bunny. But that's a story for the book. Here's the last time he does it. He eats the flower, and this time he swallows it. Oh no, you need to put that flower back. What? He says he can put it back by magic. Watch this. 1, 2, 3! Just like that? And how about that? Harry the Magic Rabbit, let's all give him a round of applause, boys and girls, and you can take the flower and head off like this. So, that is my white standing rabbit and the way I use him with the blooming flower. Now, a long time ago, somebody invented a magic trick that looked like this. A coloring book that you can flip through And it's blank at one point, then it becomes lines, then it becomes colored pictures. I'm not doing the coloring book today, but let me show you something that I've added. Long ago, this was actually given as a part of the trick Instant Art by Supreme Magic. They gave you this black scarf that you take like this, and you wave it back and forth, and it changes to colors. Now, what I used to do with Instant Art and later a coloring book was have the children pull colors off their clothing, throw them up here, and I'd pretend to catch them. Then I'd get ready with the coloring book. A couple of kids are helping me on stage, and I would take this scarf that I'm holding right here. This is what Mr. Goshman calls a shake silk, and I think I just shook it down into the inside of the scarf. That's okay, I'll get a hold of it. And then by twirling it around, I made the colors disappear and they went into the coloring book. So this is a scarf that just turns inside out. If you shake it or you swing it back and forth, just like this, just like that, it changes color. But let's take this principle and do something else with it. This is called a jumbled number silk, and I'm going to make myself a little more room there by doing this. I bring this out in a math show, and I show the kids the numbers, and I say, these are the first six numbers of the alphabet. I mean, the number alphabet. I go, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and the kids say, no, no, no. I say, well, look at them again. It's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. They no, 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 no. Wait a minute. If you folks are so smart, I point at them, you call it the numbers. You ready? Here we go. Ready? They go 4, 1, 5, 3, 6, 2. And I go 4, 1, 5, 3, 6, 2. And I thought it said 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 the entire time. Wait a minute. I must be wrong, or it must be magic. So you see, what you've done is turn this scarf inside out from jumbled numbers to the correct numbering 1 through 6. And the kids like that just as well, and it looks like instant magic. But let me show you one more example of this. I have it right over here. And this is one that just appeared last year. I call it a snake silk because it looks kind of like a snake to me. Look at that. Red and black, okay, Jack. That was Boy Scouts. Red and yellow could hurt a fella. So I tell you what, if it's going to hurt me, I'm just going to take the thing like this and give it a really good shake. 1, 2, 3. And look where I am. I've got a red and a yellow scarf, and I can put them together and produce La Paloma, the White Magic Dove. How about that? There she is. Look at that right there. Now, let's back up just a second. This is called a snake silk, and it works just like the other two, but it has the addition of another silk. So what you do is turn the snake silk inside out. Here we go. And then you take the yellow one, wad it up like this a little bit, and you poke it down inside the plain red part, just so. Here we go. And you get the two ends side by side. Then, in my case, I added this sponge Goshman dove just for a little production. Wad him up in my hand. So I pick this up, talk about it, hold on to the two ends on the inside, give it a shake or two, and look, it splits into two silk scarves. You can then put them together and make your magic dove appear. Here he is right here, Birdie the Magic Bird or whatever. In fact, for a joke, you can say, now that we've done that, I can just fold him up and put him back in the suitcase. The snake silk, the jumbled number silk, and the original shake silk or color-changing streamer. That's part one of Kids Love This, and so will you.